So today's program is opening by Agnes from Willow Diocese, welcome speech by Chelsea Rachel from Madras Diocese. Class will be taken by Mr. Alex George, Indian Postal Service. Vote of thanks will be Elizabeth Thomas, Cochin Diocese. Concluding by K. Anchura from Krishna Godavari Diocese. See, the speaker will be joining at 6:40 only. So I would like to show his biodata. This is to inspire you or motivate you. Mr. Alexander George, he's more than 8 years of experience as a Group A officer from Government of India. Professional experience included several responsibilities requiring detailed technical analysis and coherent organization of situational information. Professional experience in recruitment and training, particularly skilled developing relationships with customers, internal and external, to understand their requirements. Profession in delivering information in formal reports or as a presentations and desk level briefings to customers in government and superiors. Experience in developing grassroots personal data collection initiatives for social and developmental initiatives. Experience in designing systems for clearing project bottlenecks affecting throughput efficiency. Profession in policy formulations, diplomatic representations, and maintaining international relationships. He is now the head of the Ernakulam Lakshadweep Postal Division. Earlier, he served in New Delhi, Kottayam, Coimbatore, and a probation officer in Indian Postal Service, a lecturer and academic coordinator, Civil Service Institute, Kerala, technical officer of MR of India, MR of Limited. His achievements are, he won DAC Seva Award for Excellence in Public Administration during 2017-18, pioneered for the first time in India a key postal department social program in Shirivani Adwaram tribal area during officer tenure in charge of Coimbatore Postal Division, provided relief initiatives for local population by emergency organization and implementation of small denomination currency exchanges for the sick and elderly in support of Government of India demonetization efforts in 2016, led a pioneering initiative to provide a secure and confidential channel of communication between children and young citizens and local law enforcement leaders, organized and launched a record-breaking project as cited in the Media Book of Records to promote mentoring efforts for more than 6,000 children. Led government to citizen outreach events in order to ensure transparency in public administration. Conducted SecureX workshop hosted by India for smooth exchange of data for security agencies. Pioneered in the state of the art of technology for the mid-air clearance of articles through advanced exchange of data. Pioneered in historic agreement between India and USA for electronic data exchange. Member of high-level committee for anti-smuggling and narcotics control under Ministry of Home Affairs, Government of India. Member of the cabinet committee, member of committee under Cabinet Secretary to review and identify redundant legislations. Represented India in various forums under Asia-Pacific Postal Union, headquartered at Bangkok, Thailand. Represented India in various committees under Universal Postal Union of United Nations, headquartered at Bern, Switzerland. He got an MSc Analytical Chemistry from Mahatma Gandhi University, Kottayam, and he is a Macro Master's in Data, Economics and Development Policy, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, USA, Certificate in Introduction to Digital Journalism, Reuters, Certificate in Making Sense of News, University of Hong Kong, and State University of New York. Professional Certificate in MediaWise, Water Project Fact Checking, and Poynter Institute, USA. Professional Certificate in Civic Online Reasoning, Sorting Truth and from Fiction, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, USA. I call upon Agnes for opening prayer.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful who is going to lead us in this section. Let the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart be acceptable in your sight. Be with us and guide us. Be with all the attendees who are present here. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. I call upon Charles Sir Richard from Madras Diocese for welcome speech.
Good evening to everyone. I thank our Lord and Jesus Christ for this precious day and wonderful evening. It is my pleasure to welcome every one of you for being here with us today for this online webinar. A warm welcome to Honorable Chief Guest, respected Professor Dr. Matthew Koshi Sir, Eco-Director Synod, Organizing Committee, Teacher Coordinators, and all the participants from various dioceses. I cordially welcome our Chief Guest, Sir Mr. Alexan George, who is the Division Head of Postal Section of Ernakulam and Lakshadweep. More than 8 years of experience as a Group A officer, Government of India. Won Dog Seva Award for Excellence in Public Administration during 2017-18. He is proficient in delivering information in formal reports or as presentations and desk-level briefing to customers in government and superiors. I assure you all that you will thoroughly enjoy the session and will definitely take home some learnings home today. Once again, I welcome you all.
Thank you, Ray, Chelsea. Now, Alexan George will deliver the lecture. And there are students from 5 states of India, southern states of India, 9, 10, 11, and 12. So I cordially welcome Alexan George to take the class.
Good evening to one and all in the meeting, respected Matthew sir. I was supposed to join at 6:30, but due to some official requirements, I was not able to keep up my time like that. And I feel so sorry for being late, but I'm so happy to see you all assembling here to hear a few words of lecture from my side. The topic given for today's lecture is self-empowerment. Self-empowerment, I don't know how many of you are familiar with the word self-empowerment, because self-empowerment has two parts in that. One is self and second is empowerment. So we will focus. So it has two parts, basically, self and empowerment. So we will focus our lecture on these two parts, that how to achieve self-empowerment in your life and what is basically self-empowerment. So that will be our basic motive. I will try to explain from my part according to my humble abilities. So what do you mean by self? And before starting into the small lecture, I would like to say that whatever you are hearing, you please try to understand. And if you have any doubts in between, we can have a interactive section after 30 minutes or 40 minutes according to the span of the lecture. And after that, we can have an interactive session. So you can reserve all of your questions towards the last of the session, okay? So basically, it has two parts, that is self and empowerment. So we need to understand basically what is self and how to empower yourself. If we are analyzing the meaning of the correct meaning of the word, then personal empowerment or self-empowerment, we can interchange the word in between personal empowerment, because self means personal. Self-empowerment or personal empowerment is talks about taking control of your own life. How to take control of your own life and how to make decisions and how to make, how to enable yourself in this world to cope up with its challenges. So this is what basically personal empowerment or self-empowerment means. I will explain it once again. It just means that how to take control of your life, how to decide, how to take decisions in your life, and how to make yourself prepared to face the challenges you are going to face in this world. Because this world, as you know, it's a very competitive world. It's the world outside your home is very much competitive, and you need to survive in that competition. You might have heard about Herbert Spencer's survival of the fittest principle. In this particular scenario, in this particular world, actually those people survive who are the fittest. So how to make yourself fit into this world? That is a basic meaning of empowerment or personal empowerment. So it is associated with basic attributes like how to increase your self-esteem, how to increase your self-confidence, how to cope up with the various challenges you are receiving in your day-to-day life. So it is basically, it gives a basic idea. The lecture is supposed to give you a basic idea of how to convert your basic self to cope up with the challenges which you are facing in your life. That is a basic line of my lecture. So if you are analyzing the initial part, what is your self? Self means what? Your personality means what? Is it the physical attributes? Is it the kind of, the things which you buy in your capacity? Is it the big house? Is it the big car? Is it the big job? Is it the, the family? Is it the, so what do you mean by the self? Self, it essentially means that it is your essential being. Self means your essential being, which distinguishes you from others. If, for example, Alex St. George has certain qualities. Alex St. George has certain attributes which make Alex St. George different from somebody else. So that means those attributes, it is not the car which I own. It is not which the house I own. It is not which the religion in which I believe. It is not the degrees which I hold. It means the basic attributes, the basic qualities as a human being. What all are the qualities which make me unique from others? Because as you know, each person in this world is entirely unique. They are made unique. There is no other person like Alex St. George in this world. You can find a number of similarities. Why I am using Alex St. George again? And I am not familiar with any of your names. That is why I'm using the word Alex St. George again and again. So Alex St. George, that person, that particular person, what all are the qualities, what all are the, the characters which makes me unique? So as a human being, how do I imbibe all these qualities? How do I imbibe all these characters? A human being, when he or she is born into this world, the motivational guru says they are an unwritten plaque. They are an unwritten slate. There is nothing there. After that, from the moment you are born into this world, you are interacting with your surroundings. And from these surroundings, you imbibe all the qualities in your life. And it is, the science has now gone into that much deep depth. It has reached that it has now gained that much of level of knowledge that it is now able to tell us that it is not the any particular age in which we are gaining, we are stopping the learning process. We are now talking about neuroplasticity, where we say that our brain is a plastic brain. It has got a plasticity, which means every time till the end of your life, till the last breath of your life, you are learning, you are empowering yourself, you are, your brain is getting developed. How your brain acts, how your brain develops, it is through neural connections. You know that in brain, there are different kind of cells, which brain cells, which we call as neurons. And those neurons make chemical pathways. And those chemical pathways control all our emotions, control all our thoughts. And those, chemical pathways, it is being formed. It is not forming on its own. It is just like a computer. It is just like, what we discuss as artificial. It is learning from the surroundings. From around you, you are learning actually, even if you're not actively learning, you're passively learning. And so the moment you are born, you're actually learning, you start learning from your surroundings. A newborn knows the smell of its mother. Her mother or his mother, he can differentiate between his or her mother and any other person. So from that moment onwards, you are able to distinguish and you are able to make connections. And out of those connections, you formulate your interactions. And out of these interactions, your character is formed. From the surroundings around you, see, if you are born in Tirunelveli, you have a certain surroundings. If you are born in, Switzerland, in Bern, so for example, then your surroundings would be different. A person who is being brought up there in Switzerland, in Bern, and a person who is born in India, in Tirunelveli, though they imbibe different kind of qualities, their characters would be different, definitely, because their cultures are different. Their surroundings are different. And so they form as unique persons. You don't have to consider Tirunelveli and Switzerland for this example. The very house in which you are living, it's entirely another surrounding. And the next house also, the person living in your house and the person living in the next house, in your adjacent house, both of them have different qualities. Both of them develop different characters. Both of them may imbibe different cultural values also. So in that manner, every person who is born into this world, who is interacting with you, has unique qualities. So that is called self. And how you mold yourself, how you empower you, how you gain knowledge. So what is empowering you? Basically, you have to acquire knowledge. That knowledge is going to empower you. See, knowledge is not the knowledge which we are learning from school, which we are learning from books. It is everything and anything from morning till evening, till you are awake, even in subconscious mind also, you are learning. So that part, that is called the learning purpose. So how you empower, enables you to become stronger. It enables you to become more confident. See, for example, if you're, I will just explain that if you're visiting a new place, almost all the roads there in that town, if you're visiting a certain part of your, a different town, different from that of your hometown, you are visiting that for the first time, almost all the roads will look alike for you. Every road will look alike for you, but you cannot spot the difference. If you go to some other part of the country, for example, from South India, if you go to a Northeast or Northeast people, when they come to the South of our country, the people cannot spot the difference initially. Initially, everybody will look alike. It is because of the lack of knowledge. We are not able to spot the differences. Our brain is not empowered to spot the differences. In that particular way, how we overcome that, we start learning. We start acquiring knowledge. And we become more stronger in that area. We can spot the differences between people. For example, another example I would give you, there are identical twins. See, as an outsider, you won't be able to tell what is the difference between or how you identify Mr. Nitesh and Mr. Sugish, two different persons. They are identical. And you are not able to tell the difference. But their mother and father, they will be able to spot the difference. They can very well know who is Nitesh and who is Sugish. How? It is through the constant interaction. Through the constant interaction, they gain the knowledge and they become stronger in that area. So empowerment basically means becoming stronger and gaining knowledge. And that's how you control your life. When you start acquiring knowledge, you empower yourself and you mold yourself. And this is what is known as self-empowerment. I hope the part is clear to you. So how to gain knowledge? Gaining knowledge has different aspects. One is the first and the foremost part is gaining knowledge. Knowledge, you know, you have to gain knowledge in two different areas. That is the only area I will say. One is knowing thyself, knowing yourself, your attributes, your qualities, how you are aspiring, your desires, your decisions, how you yourself, all these things are going to matter. So once again, I will tell so for gaining knowledge, there are two parts. One is knowing thyself and knowing your surroundings. So once you need to understand yourself, at the same time, you need to understand your surrounding. These are the two aspects of gaining knowledge. So knowledge enables you to survive. Knowledge enables you to compete. Knowledge enables you to prosper. If you are analyzing the trajectory of the growth of human beings, the Homo sapiens, if we are, you know, analyzing it as a species, this Homo sapiens, you know, we are now in the top of the food chain. I would like each of you to read the Homo sapiens by Yuval Noah Harari, because it's a wonderful book. And explaining how the human beings have, you know, climbed up to the top of the food chain. Many of you might have read it. Those who are not, you can go and take it from some library and read it. It's a wonderful book. So in that book, he explains how Homo sapiens have climbed to the top of the food chain. How we are, you know, able to survive in this world, because initially when we started, we are like any other species. We are like any other species in the animal kingdom. We are just like, you know, lions. We had to compete with compete in the wild. We have to live in the jungle. All those basic attributes were the same. We were all given the same surroundings. And in that particular scenario, from that particular scenario, I will say in the last 50,000 or 1 lakh years, it has been a wonderful trajectory. That trajectory has made ourselves to the top of this food chain. So if you understand that journey, then you will understand what is the meaning of knowledge. So knowledge means how to enable you to survive. It gives you the basic principle. It gives you the basic techniques to how to compete in that world. Because, you know, for finding food, later on when we discovered agriculture and all, we were able to cultivate our own food But in the jungle, actually, we had to fight for our food. So how to compete? Those same things are continuing in different manner in the current world also. You know, you need to find out food. You need to find out a job. You need to, for that, you need a certain type of technical knowledge, which you are learning from your school. You are writing some examination and you are getting into a job solely to find a way of living. You are fine, and you compete there, you know, in the each of your jobs which you are going to enter. There is competition between your peer groups. Healthy competitions always allow us to compete between our peer groups, and we enables ourselves to come to the top. And then you prosper, actually. You spread in this world. So this is what Bible also says. Initially, man was created, and after that, the man was, you know, left out to the world when he did the sin. They went out of the Eden, and after that, they were going to toil in the earth. They were going to eat the bread out of their sweat. So you are basically going to compete. Initially, you survived, and then you compete, and then they prospered. So this is what we learn in biology, and we learn in history also. So these knowledge, the kind of knowledge which you are able to compete, which enable you to survive, makes you prosper. So the first thing is how to know thyself. Knowing thyself, your aspirations, for that you need to introspect each and every day into you, how you are making decisions. What all are your, how you have gained knowledge, how you have survived today, what all are the learnings which you learned today? It's a daily basis analysis. Introspect, then later on you achieve more. And each day you have to gain knowledge. It enables you to live in this world. The second aspect is knowing surrounding. It's more important. Why I'm saying it's knowing thyself is, you know, if you are able to do it on your own, but you need to know your surroundings also. And you need to enable the surroundings to make you, to prosper in this world, to survive in this world. You have to enable, you have to domesticate your surroundings. That is from where we use the word domestication. So domesticating your surroundings to enable your survival. So for that, you need to first of all understand what is your surroundings. What are the challenges associated with your surroundings? So if you see a small plant, if you're having the habit of observing plants, watering plants, loving plants, anything, it is better than the animal. The example would be better than any other animal. That's why I'm quoting plant example. If you are planting a seed, after that it comes out, it sprouts out, then it spreads its roots. Why it spreads its roots? Because you need to find out water, you need to find out food. It is through those processes, it is searching its surroundings and it is domesticating the surroundings to enable its survival. So that is how you domesticate your surroundings. So the surroundings around it are, you know, it would be very an arid area. It won't find easy water there. It won't find easy food there. So it extends its root till it finds its food and water. So that is how you have to domesticate your surroundings. Your surroundings are very important because that enables your being. Man cannot be an island. Man can never prosper as an island. He cannot remain on his own. He or she cannot remain on his own. We need interconnectedness. I was reading a particular book last week. It's called Antidote. It is written by a person called Oliver Bergman. He's a Wall Street journalist. And he has written this book, I think, in 2012 or something like that. And in that, there is a beautiful example. He says that when the civilization began, when the civilization began, it has not begun with the discovery of wheel. It has not begun with the discovery of steam engine. It has not begun with, any other material things. It has begun with in a simple incident in history. The archaeologist, the biologist, when they were able to find out a fossil, where, the bond, the thigh bone, they were able to discover a particular human being whose thigh bone got joined. That fossil, that skeleton, they got it. What is the significance of that? Because, in our 204 or 6 bones in our human body, the most difficult bone to get rejoined is the thigh bone. Without that, you cannot walk. It has been discovered at least 10,000 years back or something like that. At that point, he says that the history has begun. Why? Because human beings till that time were in a jungle and they were taking care of themselves. They were taking care of themselves from the threats of the jungle. They will flee, they will fly, and they will make themselves safe from all the threats. They may not be able to think beyond. At this point, see how he has survived, how that skeleton has survived, how it has survived, because there is a joining. How it has survived, those people around that particular person has protected him. So that protection, that interconnectedness, that is called networking. That point is called the point of cooperation. From that point, our civilization has begun. From there, we started imbibing all those values like love, sharing, all those good values which we use to enable ourselves to be useful for others. That is called sharing, or that is called cooperation, that is called interconnectedness. So empowerment through interconnectedness. That is why I asked you to focus more on your surroundings. Knowing thyself is very important. At the same time, knowing your surroundings is more important than knowing thyself. So interconnectedness and cooperation has enabled this human being, the species called Homo sapiens, it has enabled us to climb to the top of the food chain. That is why the philosophers have said that man cannot continue as an island. He's a social animal. She cannot continue being alone. You need so much of support systems. See, mankind currently, the present scenario, mankind is facing the most adverse times in the human history, the recorded human history. We are facing such a adverse time. Nowhere there is a match with this kind of challenges which we are seeing right now. Almost every part of the world, there is not even a single part of the world which the COVID has not attacked us. It has attacked almost all parts of the world, globe. But still we are surviving. How? We are making vaccine in a short span of time. I will say if you are analyzing the medicine industry, pharmaceutical industry, this is a very short span of time in which we are able to produce so many vaccines. How we were able to do it? Somebody researching in US, somebody researching in Europe, somebody researching in Asia, somebody researching in Africa. They are all coming together into a common platform, and they are interacting each other. They are sharing their informations. They are sharing their crucial discoveries. And after that, they are making vaccines. So this is where the cooperation comes. This is what basically what Bible teaches us, to cooperate, to love and share. To love, these words have become more important in such adverse times, in these challenging times. So maintaining network and importance of sharing, all those things are very much important in such a pandemic hit world. You will be understanding it better in the context of pandemic. Who is a friend? For understanding and maintaining your network, you need to understand who is a friend. The friend, that particular word, if you are searching it in a dictionary, it goes to a Latin root of free. Friend comes from a Latin root of free. Free means, you know, sharing, love, all those meanings are associated with the word free. And from there, a friend comes. So who is an enemy? Who is not a friend? You need to understand both. Whom you can cooperate with and whom you cannot cooperate with. But Jesus has told us that, you know, to make your enemy also your friend. So that is very important. There are no enemies in this world. That concept is very beautiful. It enables you for more cooperation. Who is an enemy? There is no thing like an enemy in this world. There are only friends. Even the word enemy, it comes from, again, a French word called ennemi, which simply means that who is not a friend. That is only distinction. So there is no enemy at all. There are only friends. Friends you can interact with may not be interacting right now. You can convince them and you can bring it into your surroundings. So we need so much of support systems. That is where I quoted the question of who is your friend. We need so much of support system. Man cannot continue as an island. So in this world, actually, we better understand. We understand the importance of the word called friend, the word called cooperation, the word called sharing, the word called love. You know, we are all from the different parts of the country interacting into this Zoom platform. We are sharing, actually. We are sharing information. We are sharing. We are cooperating. We are seeing each other. And in this COVID hit world where we cannot have a physical meeting, we are having a virtual meeting. And after that, we are interacting. So this is how you cooperate. This is how you share. And share comes out of your love. And love means what, you know, love means actually, again, it's a zero-sum game. If you have played badminton, if you have played tennis, the starting point is love. That zero, we call it as love, right? When we begin the game, we say that love. Love all. And after that, we begin. So it's a zero. Zero means there is no gain. At that time, there is no gain. It's a zero-sum game. Mathematics, we call it, it is zero-sum game. It means there is no gain for anyone. At that point, we share. At that point, friendship arises. When there is no gain for each other, you call, you know, you're just loving for the sake of love. You're cooperating for the sake of cooperating. There is no gain expected. Then that becomes pure love. All these values which we are imbibing enables you to empower yourself, enables you to, or empowers you to face the challenges in this world, what is set before you. So these things combined together become self-empowerment. I'm going to wind up my session. After that, we will interact in a more interactive session. What the crux of my today's lecture is, self-empowerment cannot be attained, cannot be achieved through a single man's efforts. It needs lots of help from others. You need lots of support system, not only your parents, not only your siblings, not only your relatives. You need to go out of the world. You need to interact with your people around you. You need to learn lots of things from others, and thus you empower yourself to face the challenges which is set before you in these challenging times. So I think by these basic notes, I am just winding up the session, and after that we can continue in a more interactive session. Thank you.
You can ask questions or you can write in the chat box. Please write in the chat box or you can unmute the mic and ask questions.
Can you tell the book name, sir? Which book, dear? Which book? I might have spoke about different books. The last one I remember is that Oliver Berkman's Antidote. Was that the one? Okay. It's a beautiful book. It's a beautiful book. It is actually asking us to, you know, rethink, because we are familiar with all those positive attitudes, how to, the seven habits of effective people, all those positive, we can say, positive thoughts. So it is arising out of something called Stoic philosophy, which we say Marcus Aurelius, Aristotle, etc. So this Stoic philosophy is basically, you know, asking us to view negative things. Negative things in the sense, do not flee from the negative thoughts. You just observe it, you imbibe it, and after that, there is nothing like negative thoughts. So there is nothing like negative or positive thoughts. There are only thoughts. There are no negative emotion, there is positive emotion, there are only emotions. Whether to make it positive or negative, it only depends upon your perspective of that. Because emotions are something which is a chemical shoot up in your mind. And if you are understanding that, then it becomes, if you are, you know, approaching it with a prejudiced mind, then it becomes positive or negative. Instead, you just take it as a thought, and after that, whether to, don't think even to make it positive or negative, just observe the thought and leave it. It's a Stoic philosophy. So his Antidote, it is Antidote. Antidote. So Antidote is just enabling us to welcome the negative thoughts and do not bother about negative thoughts. I hope whatever I shared with you was, you understood it, right?
Please write in the chat box whether it is yes or no. Yes, sir, is coming.
Yeah. Okay. I understood.
They are accustomed, they are not accustomed with this Zoom meetings, last 5 classes. So they are adjusting with this. So
yeah, that is how you learn, no? That is how you empower yourself. That's my whole point of lecture. These virtual platforms, at least that is going to be the future. This, we cannot even call it as virtual world. This is the real world now. In almost all the you know, interactive sessions, interactions which we are conducting now, even in government, in private field, everywhere, this is the real world now. Because we are scared still to go out to interact with people, but that point will come definitely through the vaccination drive, which the government is doing now. The point will definitely come, and that we need to come out of our houses also. That is again where you learn to live with your peers. You understand with them, you understand their culture, they understand yours, you give your things to them, they share theirs to you, and all those things needs to happen, then only the real empowerment comes. So we are just waiting out in this virtual world for a better future. So how can we identify a friendship is real or not? See, friendship, it is always real. The interactions are always real. Something is happening in that relation. Whether it is real in the sense, whether that person will, you know, do certain things for you, that depends upon the kind of, you know, the depth of love which you share between that person or and you. Otherwise, all the interactions are real only. And there is nothing like unreal interactions or unreal cooperation or unreal relations. All are real relations only, but the depth varies. There will be a particular person who will do, who will, if I call him in the night, he will come out and do what I ask him. And there will be a person who will say that let's meet in the morning. Doesn't mean that the person who is asking me to meet in the morning, he is not having that kind of friendship with me, or in the friendship scale. There is nothing like friendship scale, right? In that particular friendship scale, I award him 10. The one who comes out for hanging out with me, or basically, or again, you can test. If you want to test your friendship, I would say you better not attempt it, because again, we don't know who is going to help you in troubled times and all. One thing we can be sure that in troubled times, you need support system, and that is where you need the friendship to come real. So you can count on that. Yeah, when a challenging times comes for you, if that friend stand with you, act as a support for you, then he's a real friend. Who wrote Homo Sapiens? Please name the author. That is Yuval Noah Harari. Yuval Noah Harari. How to overcome our negative thoughts. That's what I just mentioned. There are nothing like negative or positive. There is only thoughts. We award positive and negative to it. It's our perspective in which we award negative or positive. There are only thoughts. For example, negative thought think is, see, if the current is gone now, the electricity is gone now, then we start getting anxious about it. We term it as a negative thought. Getting anxiety is a negative thought. But why anxiety is coming? Because we see that scenario very adverse for us. See, there is no electricity and you are sweating, then you can definitely move out. Find some, find some other means to settle yourself down. You can light a candle and can have light. You don't have electricity, but the light is being given by the candle. So you have a way out. Every situation has a way out if you think in that manner. So there are nothing like negative thoughts. That is a basic understanding of that antidote book, which I'm saying. I'm not saying that is a perfect book or perfect perspective to view this world. You can have your own, but it is a compatible view, in the sense that how to avoid anxiety, how to overcome fear, all those things. This kind of approach, that is what I call it as a stoic approach. It is more better. That is where we, that kind of Buddhism, and many of the Buddhist teachings are also there in our Christianity. You are not viewing the world, the things like, you should not get anxious about today. Whatever, you should not store it for tomorrow. All these are how to avoid your anxiety and fear. So those things will definitely help us to overcome these negative or positive attached to our thoughts. So just take that thought and see that, observe that thought. That is the way to overcome it. Fear away. Don't run away. Don't run away from that particular moment. Instead, you embrace it. It will slowly wither away. It will slowly wither away. I hope I have answered your question here. Is there joy, Christy?
Excuse me, sir. So in this present scenario, many students are under stress now, and they feel like running away from the stress. So what is the solution for them? I mean, now they always jump into wrong conclusions. So to avoid that, what can be done?
You're saying that currently children
are... this current scenario, due to the COVID times, there are many students are feeling a lot of stress within them because they're not able to move. Now, as it is, they are able to move outside. But still, some of them, their stress is so much that they jump into wrong conclusions. So how can we divert their minds and bring them back to the normal?
One thing is,
that question is from a teacher, not from a student.
Okay. It was a wonderful question, actually.
That is also in the chat box also.
Okay, how can I view the chat box?
Okay, that is the same question which is written in the chat box also.
I'll repeat it once.
But I'm not able to wait. I don't know some. Can you hear me? I will say it once again, whatever you have asked.
Okay.
To overcome the stress of the students who are not able to get out of their houses, right, in this current scenario.
Yeah.
So my humble idea is that we cannot change the situation currently. That we have to make them understand that this is the situation. These are the dangers awaiting us outside. So if we are going to exercise it without any precaution, then we will be caught up in a more stressful scenario. So that is why we are confining ourselves. Nobody is putting us inside. Nobody is, you know, it is not like a jail. We are choosing this particular situation for our benefit. So there is, if you are viewing that, then that particular stress will be somewhat alleviated. I'm not saying that it will completely go away. At the same time, see, there are many people like us who are facing the same situation. We are not alone in this. We are not alone in this, and this is not a particular situation for us again. There are many people like this, and 100 crores of people like this, and they are waiting for the right time to come out. So there is no point in getting anxious about it. Whatever surroundings you are having, whatever limited surroundings you are having, you need to find yourself in that particular engagement in that particular surrounding. When we become stressed or when we become over anxious, we don't have any other thought other than that. If you are getting engaged, actually that stress will be getting alleviated again. If we are imagining ourselves in a stressful scenario, or if we are saying that this is my fate, or even if you are running away from that also, if you're getting up in the morning, and after that, in the name of meditation, we are all trying to, stop all this negative thinking, then again, that is a wrong strategy, I would say. Instead, you embrace it, understand it. The solution is well inside that particular situation. It is a scenario given by you to yourself to save from a further stressful scenario. For making a better future, you are confining yourself now. So that is for your benefit only. Find out some engagements in this given situation and try to find some work. If work is properly given and work is properly found out, then the stress would be going out. I hope I have answered.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Any other questions? So thank you, sir, for your very informative speech. I call upon Elizabeth Thomas from Cochin Diocese to propose vote of thanks.
Sir, am I audible?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
A very warm and delightful evening to one and all present here. Honorable Chief Guest Alexine George IPS, the Division Head of Postal Section of Ernakulam and Lakshadweep, respected Matthew Koshi Sir, Eco Director CNET, the Technical and Management Team of CNET, Eco Directors, Teacher Coordinators, and all the students and participants of this program. It gives me immense pleasure to propose vote of thanks for this useful webinar about self-empowerment. First of all, I extend my sincere thanks to the Almighty God for making today's event a resounding success. I extend my gratitude to Alexine George Sir to taking out time from his busy schedule to grace this event. I express my deep sense of thanks and appreciation for encouraging us with your valuable thoughts on self-empowerment. We got to understand that self-empowerment isn't merely about a single person, but we acquire it through society, friends, etc. And realize that for that we should familiarize ourselves with the surroundings. I would especially thank Dr. Matthew Koshi Sir for conducting such a thought-provoking and productive student leadership training program for us. It's very helpful for our students to improve ourselves and to sharpen our skills. I also thank all the teacher coordinators and ECHO directors for guiding us and helping us throughout the program. I use this opportunity to thank the CNET members and all others who work to make this webinar happen. I'm immensely thankful to all my dear friends attending this online webinar from various dioceses. You all played a great part in making this program successful. Once again, I thank you all for joining with us today. Have a wonderful night ahead. Thank you.
Thank you. Anshura from Krishna Godavari Diocese for concluding prayer.
Tell me, I audible?
Yes.
Let's pray. Our graceful Heavenly Father, thank you for being with us. Thank you for giving another opportunity to acknowledge you. Oh Lord, thank you for joining all together in webinar. Oh Lord, bless each one of us. Lord, bless our director, Dr. Matthew Koshi Sir, and our speaker, Mr. Alexine George Sir, IPOS. Oh Lord, give us wisdom, knowledge, and guidance. Bless all the students who are participating in these leadership qualities. Bless all the bishops, the coordinators, and technicians who are handling this Zoom meet, Father. Once again, I thank you, Lord, for being with us through this webinar, making this meet successfully. In the Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Alexine George Sir, and all the teacher coordinator students for attending this program. We will meet.
Yeah, thank you, sir. One small word also I would like to add when I was hearing the beautiful prayer. Actually, teacher, there is nothing like, counting your blessings. We are all asking for blessings. So the counting of our blessings really makes our stress away. I was just coming back from airport, Kochi airport. At that time, one of my beloved staff, actually she got her both of her leg broke, but she came enthusiastically to do some duty. There was a confidential duty at that time. She came in to do the duty on her crutches. So I asked, why are you coming? So she said, sir, I witnessed an accident where I could have, I would have been no more. I'm not able to walk, yes, that I know, but still, I'm so grateful that I am alive today. So being alive itself is a celebration. Being alive is itself the blessing. So that is how we come out of the stress. Being alive is the most important thing in our life. So if you are alive, when so much of people are dead now, so your stress should be gone, right, teacher?
Thank you, sir. I just wanted for the children. I just asked the question just to get the children out of the
stress. Yes, yes, yes.
That is why I
asked. You can convince your children also more.
Definitely, sir.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for a wonderful session, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much,
sir. Thank you. We are closing the session. Thank you.